Yes. What is the today our topic is Python parameter passing in function. You can respond anytime. So from there, what is this call by value or call by reference? These are the two stupidest term I think in C you learn. What is call by value and call by reference? But what is the problem of C is the C every variable is mutable. Say any integer, that integer is mutable, and any character array is mutable. But whenever you go for the more advanced languages like Java, we see the string is immutable. What is the advantage of immutable? But disadvantage is definitely there because it adds space complexity. So any string, if you write, if say my name is Shomnath, and my name Shomnath, I just say my name equal to Shomnath. But sometimes I write my name Shomnath Raichaudhuri. In Java and Python, both the cases, this Shomnath would be repeated. Is another new string will be created, and that string will be forgotten. So that is a typical wastage of memory. So, but at the time when the C was born in 1961, 62, 63, then the memory is very precious. Even the 32K RAM is very costly. So at the time you cannot throw away your RAM position. So at the time that language is developed. Whenever you have your mobile phone, right now have 8 GB or 6 GB RAM. Your desktop laptop might have 16 GB. So we can reuse. We can have different use of memory. It would be faster if a new string would be allocated a new bytes. So that is the reason, and that will give the more safety of the programs. So then what is the call by value and call by reference? Very simple. Whenever in Python, if you put the value in a function, it is a immutable, like tuple, or even you know that even integer, anything is immutable. Basic data types are immutable. Like even tuple is immutable. Your immutable is tuple is immutable. Frozen set is immutable, and the string is immutable, and the integer floating point is immutable. So if you any function you pass this, definitely that is we call by value, because if you put something immutable things into a function how powerful it can be, it cannot change. So then the call by value, call by reference doesn't come up here. But what is call by reference? Here, if you pass the parameter is some mutable things like a list. List you know is immutable. Set is immutable. So if you pass those, and then definitely that can be changed. So that can be call by reference. Is it clear? What is call by value and call by reference? So it depends on which data type you are passing. The Python does have luxury, C doesn't have luxury. So then you have to specifically remember which is call by value and call by reference. In C function, whenever in a function prototype, if in the function prototype you see something star or ampersand is there, that definitely call by reference. Whenever in C you ask for the value, say printf and scanf, say scanf, always is ampersand A. That is definitely a call by reference. Okay, because whenever you see in C or C++, if you see ampersand and star in the function value, that is call by reference. But call by value is traditionally much safer, but it add extra space complexity because it would create a space. So from Java, Java take one step ahead. Java string is immutable, but Python go one more step ahead. It make all its basic data types also immutable. Whenever you create a integer, that is immutable. Whenever you create a floating point number, that is immutable. But I'll come to that. So anything you pass on to Python function, it is basically call by value. And if any variable, it is a mutable one, like list is mutable. Very few things are there in mutable there. A dictionary is immutable, definitely. So those things are you can call it a callback reference. So you have to forget about star or ampersand. You have to remember only the data type. Okay, you ask any question right now. Here we see a function, and x is 10. So this is immutable. Remember, basic data type immutable. So val x, print x. So what is the output here? Say, because it's a immutable, so it is within, it is here, it is 10, but whenever it goes into a function, it changes to 15. So it will print out the 15 here. Because it is, what is it? It is the object ID. I'll come, what is object ID? It is not a pointer. I have some reservation about it in about Python. I'll tell it that. So that is object ID. That is different. This x and this x are different because the object IDs are different. When it comes out here, when I mean val x, it will print out 15. And when it come out, it will print out again 10. Because what is the reason? Basic data type in Python is immutable. Okay. Same is here. Here it is, say you are passing a list, and this list is this, it is mutable. So it goes there, and you add some value 4 here. If you print it here, it will print this 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, and whenever it will come it here, it is also 1, 2, 3, 4. So all depends which variable, what type of variable, whether immutable and immutable. That's it. Ask any question online. You can ask anything. Anyone can unmute yourself, and if you understood, it's okay. I can go ahead. Okay, so that is it. Call by, most of the cases call by value, because most of the data is immutable, and whenever list is mutable, so that is call by reference. That's simple. So in C++, you have to remember the, whether star and ampersand is passed as a value, that is this thing, that is call by reference. Other is call by value. Call by value is always safe. It is, but safe, but it is a, it takes time, okay, because you have to copy it physically, you have to copy it, so it will take time. Any question? You can this one. So this is the next screen. Next screen, you see this is the data type. I have already told what is immutable. Int, basic data type is immutable. Remember, in Python, primitive data is not primitive data, it is a primitive object. So any in Python, everything is object, unlike Java. Java, everything is a class. You can ask even a main method, you have to put a class, and within it a public static, but it has to be visible outside. That is the reason public static. Static means here that even the without the object creation, that can be run. So that is a lot of object oriented programming concept you have to clear in Java. But Python is very simple. It's just a print hello world. So, but this, whenever it's a print hello world, this hello world string is object. Okay. That is the thing. So Python int, float, long, complex, string, tuple, these are immutable. So if you pass anything there, that is called by value. And if you pass mutable objects, this is called by reference. And these are the various data types. You must go into and see it. May I move? May I go to the next slide? Anyone say please, you say yes. Or anyone have a question? You can ask question right now. Yes?
Sir, can you explain the byte, anything?
Yeah, see, everything you don't have to bottom-up approach. Go byte array is a compact way you can put your data, but Python is generally not meant for this. These are the things you I will have a special tutorial for this. I will try to make, because these are there for very specific person, very specific types. Okay. So I'll definitely, it's a mutable objects, because it has to be. Why mutable? Whenever you go to byte level, that means you are very focusing on your resource and all these things. Maybe picture processing, image processing, you might need this. So it has to be mutable object. Okay. Because mutable objects give you the faster performance, and immutable object is safe, but it is space complexity is there, because it will be copied again definitely, and so it is not that fast. Okay, so these are the data types meant for. I'll show next day, or maybe tonight I'll prepare, because right now we are a bit busy about NASA hackathon. Probably you are also. Any other question? Good question. I'll answer this. Okay, anyone other question? Should I move to next slide? Yeah, can you be louder, please, and slower?
What is memory view?
Yeah, these are all things I'll come later. This I have covered it. I'll later. Definitely, it's a good question. This area with the sample programs, it is not ready with me right now. I'll make it ready and give it to you. Okay, any more? So remember this frozen set, and what is the difference between tuple and frozen set? That a typical question asks. The frozen set cannot have duplicate values, tuple can have duplicate values. Tuple is much faster than least. Okay, both are sequence type. These are least is mutable, it is immutable. I think these things should be clear. Tuple, where is tuple is used? When their items are less than 10 or very 20, you use tuple. It will be much faster. And least is where it will be much changes than least. List is definitely slower. Anything? Okay. So this one I have covered. Next go, I think this one I was covered. I can go to the next slide. Yes, this is the typical function that you all know right now. In Python, everything is very, very brief. This is a declaration of function by def statement. If you have to remember, this is colon. And I have omitted here, but you must write triple quote. Can anybody tell me what triple quote means? You can write anything with triple quote. Can anyone? You should know this. This is called doc string. I'll come to that. Doc string is mandatory for any function writing. You should, on your NASA hackathon web page, you must maintain a doc string. Doc string is a single line. It can be multiple lines because triple quote is meant for multiple lines also. So in Python, you have to have multiple line code with the triple quote. Okay. So doc string is a description of the function in brief, and that will helpful in debugging. Okay, that's it. And this is the parameter value. And if it's immutable, then it's a call by reference. It is immutable, that is call by value. You know very well. If it's a name, it definitely is immutable. And this is a return. You can return from function, you can return it several ways. One is, if it's call by reference, you can return it here. It is an implicit returning, you could say. Call by value, if it is there, then you have to return by this way. Okay. So why the function? Can you ask the question? If a function I call, I do not return anything. Okay. Is it possible? Yes or no? Yes, it is possible. It is required. Sometimes I call a function, it doesn't return anything. Then what is the purpose? It is a call by value. It doesn't return. Whether it is worth it? Yes, worth it. I can do certain processing here. Okay, that processing reflects some place. Okay, so that generally seldom, very seldom happens. Maybe I make some printf here. Okay, I printf to the screen or something. So in function is very powerful thing. You can return it from through call by reference here. You can return by several return statement from here. So like this. This is a typical. I think if everybody should read Dennis Ritchie's C book. That is a mandatory, even off time I also read. That is a perfect book you should read anytime, because until and unless you understand C and C++, you cannot never understand, you cannot appreciate Java and Python. Okay, so C is that kind of a mother language to all. So, and there the famous program is Fahrenheit to Celsius. It around 15 lines programs are there. The whole program is compressed to only 2 lines in Python. So there is the beauty of Python. It is the definition, conversion of Fahrenheit to Celsius, and you just call, and this is it. And I'll go to the next slide. I'll go to this program online and this thing. So that is what I want to say. The body of the function should never exceed 10 lines. That is the unwritten law in Python and any good function. And there is a function is called that way. And another type of function I have already told you, that is called lambda function. Lambda function, there should not be any name. And that should be typical one line. That is two types of function. Maybe other function will come up. This is two type. One is when a function is a name. Another call is lambda function. You have to give the name lambda. And the inline function. What is the reason for lambda function? I covered in earlier classes. You see my earlier videos. Lambda function, you can call function within a function. So that is the beauty. Yes. Any question regarding this? You can ask any question. Thank you. So this is the whole quote. I'll run the quote. So this is the definition. Return. This is another definition. Nothing to learn from here. This is a simple quote. You can understand. If I run the quote, let's see. We run the quote. Is the screen is visible, please? Is the screen is
yes,
visible?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, great.
Sir.
Great. Okay. Fine. I just want to show one thing. The attach quote. I say here, int 1 equal to 5. Int 2 equal to 5. Okay. Then we call print. I want to see ID. I go type of int 1. Okay. Correct. Let's run this small code. Oh, great. So I want to have an ID also. So I should have print. Print ID of int 1. Correct. Let's try. Oh, great. So if I press right now, print id of int 2. I am not pressing run button. Correct, sorry. I am not pressing run button. Yeah, it is. This is visible, this portion of the code. I have not pressed run button yet. What should be print ID int 2. What should be there? Output of this line. Can anyone tell me the answer? Yes. Yes,
probably
make your mic on. Louder.
Probably the address.
Why probably? After 3 weeks or 4 weeks, you say probably. The probably doesn't work in programming world. You have to be 100%.
No, probably, only the address.
No, what is the value will come? Whenever you say print ID int 1, what would be the value? I just want that. Anyone?
Sir, it will be the address of
no,
the...
No, that's it. What is the address?
Sir, it can be stored anywhere in the memory. How can I know that?
No, no, then you missed the classes. Subhashish sir and I already told. Anyone, please? Sorry, you cannot answer. It is... you should be able to see that. You should be able to tell me the address right now without running this. Please, anyone? Anyone? Any guess? Any guess? What should be the value? INT1, the value is there. Let's be more explicit. INT1, the value is 109.14624. Okay? And what should be this value? INT2. Remember, this INT1 has the same value, 5. INT2 is the same. Yes. Who said? Okay, anyone. Let's try. Let's see, check your answer. Yeah, it is the same. But this is one, I think, one of the stupidest things for Python. Because if Python is, everything is mutable, basic data type is mutable, why they make this confusion? That I do not understand. Are you getting my questions? Because by definition, INT1 is immutable, okay? And I have declared is INT1 and initial is 5. And then INT2, by definition, Python said that is immutable. So why they keep the same ID? Yeah, that design issues, even the how Van has did it. But you have to understand, but you have to remember it. But whenever I change subsequently, int2 is a 6, that would be changed. Okay, but is that is a little, I think, a little faux pas that even it is int1 is immutable, their address is same. Remember, this is not a pointer. It is a kind of identification you can check from debugging. So this is also immutable. So if you try is, if you change it int1, int2 to any other number, so right now it would be changed. It should be changed. Yeah, see here, original 24 is meant for int1 and this is changed. So what I want to say that when the value changes, Python internally ID changes, but I think the design should have been better. Whenever you declare a new value, a new variable name, there should be separate ID. What is the, because you have a plenty of memory, what is the reason for conserving your space giving this thing? But the concept is, here it is all our object. That's thing you should learn. What we learn from Python, this all our objects, and they are creating as with object IDs. You can say as object pointer. If the eventually the event is the same, but if you create a another thing is that if you see here in a list one, say I am creating a list one, say list one, say equal to, say oh, you have a very primitive, what is the list 1, 2, okay, and say list one. Anybody you cannot understand, you please ask any question right now. No issue. This is a class. Think of it as a class. You can ask any question. Unmute and ask a question. Is it what I am trying to do? Is it sensible? Are you understanding what you want to say? Anyone can answer. What I have done here, I am creating a list. List is no, it is a immutable things with the same values. Same values. Then it is. Can you guess me whether these two numbers are different or not different? Like this. Anyone? Otherwise, we'll try. Others will try. Let's see from the run from beginning. Here definitely it will change, and here is also the same. See, though it is a same values, though it is a mutable, but and they have seen it. They have seen it. They are the same values, so they give a same ID, same as this. Though integer one is a immutable one, list one is a mutable one, because of the same values. If you change the values, see if we change the values, say one
sir,
value.
You have printed the same list both times.
Okay, I think yeah. You are very good. Absolutely, I am also. Yes. I have copied it. It should be changed. Yes. Absolutely correct. I am mistaken. It is, now the value should come different. Let's see. Yeah, say the value in list 1, 1 comma 2, list 2, 1 comma 2, both are mutable things. And but Python, though they are seeing it the same values, by the same logic, they should have the object ID would be the same. But because the list is basically mutable, they have assigned a separate pointer, though they are the same values. Am I clear? Sorry, I have a little bit confusion earlier, but right now, what I want to say, my design criteria is the Python should have maintained a separate object ID there also. Am I sensible? Am I what I am talking is sense. Yes? Any, you ask any, anything? Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
It's okay. So, that is the thing. So, you have to remember
yes,
what...
Sir.
Yeah,
okay.
Great. So, that is the thing. So, that is, I think, I disagree with the Python. Why, what is the little amount of space saving whenever the C is a not only integer, any immutable things, if you have the same values, Python will give the same pointer. And any mutable things, like here we have list and dictionary, then they, even the same values, they have the separate object pointer. That is reasonable. Okay, I have understood. But why they go for this? That is the, I have also a little question. If you, some of you can clear me, it would be good. It is this thing. Fine. Python. Here, I have already shown this one. Let's see. This one. You please see the my earlier class video, yesterday's video. So, I should not want to repeat. I just want to see this one. This one, I think I found very interesting. Python code. Python code to demonstrate call by value. Here is a string. String is immutable. Say it is a string bppmt outside function, and a function name def test. The value is string. String means is a immutable, so it will be call by value. Okay. So you look at it, whether it is a string. String is immutable, so it is a call by value. So then the string, I change the string. Whatever is coming. BP inside function, I'll print it, and then the this should be the printout. Then here the program begins. I call test string. So first go to the function. This will print. Then I'll come out of the test string. The, I say print outside function the string. This should be the output. So is the code is I think it is understood. Very simple code. So I should run it once more and check it. Yeah. Any question? I think, any question?
No, sir.
So, you have understood, they, it depends on the whether it is a mutable or immutable. Let's do this for list. Okay, let's do this for list. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, this is call by reference. Why I am coming call by reference? Because it's a list. Yeah, whenever you say pass on a list, it's a mutable, it is be call by reference. Whether you change it or not, it's a call by reference. So here the same thing is a function. Add more list, pass the list, list append, I so append 50 here and print inside list. And here I say initialize, this is the course code begins here. 10, 20, 30, 40, add more. This is the function will be called. 50 would be attached and they will print out from this place and outside it, print out to this place. This should be the printout. We can fire the code once more to see whether it is. Yeah. Any doubt? So, this is a exactly call by reference. Why call by reference? Because in a function, you put the value which is changeable. So, if the, if you put two values, one is mutable, one is immutable, what should I call? Call by value or call by reference? I should call by reference. Because call by value is purely pure, it should be very pure thing. It cannot be changed. Okay. So, any doubt regarding this, this portion of the code? Any doubt? Please.
No, sir.
Great. Great. Okay, fine. So, I think we have understood this, we have understood this, we have understood. This is very easy. We have understood this. This is a small error. I will correct it. This one, I covered it last day. Say, this is a typical text, is a string. And if you want to search whether this n is there or not, you can, this is the value in text. So, you run it. Is it true? Return is boolean. So, this is the function in, and this is a string, and this is also a string. Is it clear? These are some little things here and there that might be helpful. Then I come. There's a function, it's called sorted. I'll try to cover a little bit of sorting if the time permits, or I can. This is one beauty of Python. Say GCD, greatest common divisor, is one of the first known algorithm. Okay, so if you put any values there, and then if you write a code, then b not equal to 0, then is to be replaced a comma b equal to b comma a modulo b return a. This is the smallest code I have ever seen. You cannot write more smaller code in Java or Python. Forget Java, you have to lot of class definition and all, and it would run. If you just fire it, see, it changes little bit value here. Say we have a, say here say 15, and here say, which is not divisible, greatest common divisor, say it should be 1. Let's test it, what is happening. Yeah, GCD is 1. So this is a small prototype function, and definitely is the call by value, because we are passing a integer. So integer is immutable. And what is the beauty of this function? It is the is a replacement of a to b and b to a modulo. This is the whole intelligence of the function is there, and this is a while loop. Okay, so this is the one of the first algorithm the human kind is developed, Euclid GCD algorithm. Whether we are not sure whether Euclid had done it or not, maybe before that, but Euclid has this written it. So that is the GCD. Any question regarding this? This will be all available. Right now, you can ask any question on Python. I think these are covered in your class. Class person and all this, have covered or not? Please answer. Anyone, please? Yes, I have covered?
Yes, sir.
I have covered this one. I have covered, great. And this is a constructor I have covered. No? This is a constructor function, is unlike Java. Yeah, it's good. I think this I have covered. Now you are free to ask any question. And you, because before NASA, everybody should be busy in writing code. So next day I'll cover all the sorting function. If you need to know the sorting, should I start a 5 minute talk on sorting? Just tell me whether it is, or you can see my videos on sorting very recently. There I have discussed what kind of sorting, what is table sorting, what is bubble sort, what is insertion sort, what is this sort, which one is the better, is the insertion sort. It's a in-place sort, you don't need any extra space. And if you go for n log n performance, then you have to go for Mach sort. Then you get the n log, but you need extra n space. If you have n items, and another n space is required for Mach sort. And but the both are these are comparison based sort. Another type of sorting is that is index based sort, that is called count sort, and all these things. Any doubt about the sorting? If anybody has any doubt of the sorting, at least you don't have to write algorithm, at least you should know. What is the different kind of sorting? Just I am quickly showing what is the different types of sorting. If the time permits, I have. Is the screen is visible? Hello? Hello, is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Why the
Yes, sir.
sorting is required?
Yes, sir.
Because most of the values, every time the sorting is going around. If you see Google, if you see Facebook, Amazon, every right site, there always a sorting is going on. What is the advantage of sorting? If you put your data unsorted, say at your home also, you put the books at some place, you put clothes at some place, at least you should sort it. At least you should not put in your clothing almirah books. Okay, sometimes some people do, I also sometimes do, but that should not be. So you should books where the books should be, and books, if it is a novel section, that should be different section, so searching would be easier. So that is the reason of sorting. It doesn't have to be exactly sorted, but it has to be sorted for getting it, finding out. So every time you need it, whenever you Google search, Google will give lots of information to you. It doesn't mean that it goes at that time only search. So they all keep the data which will be probable if the questions might be. They put it in a already sorted and they quickly find it out because they have put it in a sorted things. So that would be very good for searching, for selection. If you want to see who was the first, second, or second and third, second, third, fourth positions. So all selection criterias, if the data is sorted, if the duplicates, triplicates, or there are four values, you can find it. Or distribution, whether how many percentage is more than mean, how many percentage is less than mean. So okay, so this is the median values. So you can get this. So sorting is a must. So even if and sorting algorithm is always evolving. So let's go for two kinds of sort, mainly two kinds: comparison-based sort and non-comparison-based sort. Comparison-based sort means you compare each value with each value. That is the traditional way sort. And another is non-comparison. This is, I know the values should be distributed 1 to 100. Say if your class test, if your class test is 25, then your value cannot be 26 or cannot be minus 1. So I know that your value should be 0 to 25. So I have the prior knowledge about the distribution, prior values of this. Then maybe this kind of sort, non-comparison based sort, I'll count who got 25, how many got 25, how many got 24. That is much easier, and complexity is O(n). It can be proven, the complexity, number of items plus range of the item. Here the range is 0 to 25. So that is O(n). N means number of students. Say number of students is 200. So O 200 plus say 25, 225. That is the complexity for this sorting. But here, if we go for, if we say for class test, we try to give, we don't give, we give some floating point number, say 22.3, 22.1, say for imaginary case. I'll give 20, never given. So if I don't have knowledge, what would be the number range? Yeah, so then we have to compare each value with each value. Then thus, more general type of sorting, that is it. If you have any question, you can stop me and ask the question. And there's the algorithm is generally complexity. It cannot be O(n). Here it can be O(n). Here it can be maximum. It can be proven n log n. Okay. So, but the typical bubble sort and insertion sort will give O(n) square algorithm. But here, if you go for heap sort, if you go for quick sort, if you go for merge sort, they'll give n log n. Anytime you can interrupt me and ask me a question. So the same thing I've told, same here. So quickly go the bubble sort. This is not required. It's a bubble sort. Yeah. You see, this is the bubble sort example. So these are the numbers, say 5, 3, 8, 4, say the first pass, what the it will go, 5 will be compared. The first pass is the most valued number should be at the end. Like a bubble, it will go from left-hand side to right-hand side, the maximum value. Next pass, next maximum will go. So it will be sorted from this side. It would be like insertion sort, but not. I will tell what's the difference. So here 5 and 3, so 5 will be replaced here. Then 5 or 8, no replacement. Then 8 and 4, then 8 will go here. And 8 and 6, 8 is good. So this is now one pass. So first pass, the maximum values goes here, like a bubble. Next pass, 6 is here maximum, so 6 will stay here. Next pass, 4 will be replaced by 5. Then it will be replaced by, then 3 will be okay. At the last pass, it will be say 3, 4, 5, 6, 8. This is the bubble sort. And the complexity is O when square. I'll go to the previous slide. Here, same thing. Here it is another example. Say, because I have not chosen this is a fast one, maximum at the last 10. So it would be always there. So next thing, 5 should come here. So here is the 5 should come here. How the 5 come here? So it should be swapped here, swapped here, swapped here, 5 is come. And the last pass, you need check whether you have need swapping. So the best case, if you have already given a sorted array to bubble sort, it will just check is everything is order and the complexity is O(n). That is the best thing of bubble sort. No other sorting algorithm can give it that O(n). So bubble sort, the last checking is excellent. Every sorting algorithm should check it because most of the data generally is given is mostly sorted. Okay. So in the selection sort, we'll come to know the selection sort is the best case is O(n) squared. So anybody have any doubt of the what is bubble sort? Bubble sort is basically, I'm telling again, my objective is if you have a given data, the lowest come here and maximum can go here. The first pass, the maximum comes here. Second pass, second maximum comes here. Third pass, this will come, this one, and lowest come. This is the pass and O(n) square, the algorithm. This is bubble sort. And insertion sort would be, if I give it the insertion sort, first I go for selection sort. This is bubble sort. And what would be the selection sort? Selection sort will go and find a minimum here. Say 1. You go for this and see, oh, it is minimum. So put on there. This left hand is sorted. Then you see who is the next minimum. They find 2. Put it here. This one is sorted. So 1 and 2 is here. Then you'll go, who is the next minimum? 4. The 4 is put in here. The 1, 2, 4. Then it's 5 and 8. Who is the next minimum? 5. So it find it here. So it is here. It is here. This is called selection sort. This is a selection sort. The selection sort, what is the logic? First go, try to go to find minimum, put it here. Then try to go minimum, put it here. Then try to find minimum, put it here. That is, but this looks intelligent, but this is one of the stupidest algorithm. It is worse than bubble sort. I'll tell you why. Because even if it's a already proven, already best case is there, if you give it to selection sort, it will go again, which is the minimum, go up to this, find it one, then who is the minimum? So even O(n) squared, even the best case O(n) squared. So selection sort, you should know technically, but much better is insertion sort. What the insertion sort does, here it will go, first it don't go anywhere. It's first, see, it select two values. It will swap left, then it will say 4, then it will put 4 here and 5 here, then 1, 4, 5. Then it will say 2, then it will put 2, put it here, 1, 2, 4, 5. Then it will say 8, 8 will be there. Insertion sort, basic thing is, it from the left two side compare, minimum should put here, so like here 1 should be 1, 5. Then if you say 4 here, then 4 should be after 1, before 5. So 1, 4, 5. Then you say 2 here, 2 should go 1 after 2. Then it should 1, 2, 4, 5. Then 8 is there. That is insertion. That is the best sorting algorithm without taking any extra space. That is a stable algorithm. Any question regarding bubble sort, selection sort, and the insertion sort? Yes, please. You unmute and question. Unmute and question.
No, question.
No question. Great. So, like this is the selection sort. It will always try to find the minimum and put it. So, this is the sorted, this is unsorted. But the selection sort, the problem is that even the best case, the complexity is O n square. And this is insertion sort. So here, what is go? I will try to just next, I'll put the data and put it in sorted. So I'll in selection sort, what does it go? It go to the farthest point, find the minimum, and put it here. Then find the minimum, put it here. So always lots of unnecessary walks. So and bubble sort also, what does it do? It goes, takes the maximum to the farthest point, taking the next maximum to the this point, this next maximum this point. So sorting comes from this place, and that is also not good. But that is better than selection sort, and insertion sort is the best. It puts minimum here, then next item put minimum there, then next item put min like here. 66, 44. Which was the minimum? 44, 66. Then 99. So that should say 44, 66, 99. Then it takes the consider 55. Put 55 here. So here 44, 55, 66, 90. Then 11. Put 11 here. So this way the sorted thing comes that way, same as selection sort. But selection sort, what does it do? Selection sort first 16, then it try to go find 11, put it there. So it the final position it try to reach finally, but actually that will be slower. So that's the greedy algorithm, but it is not good. What kind of algorithm? You know, greedy means algorithm try to fix it at the first instance, but sometimes greedy algorithm doesn't work. Selection sort is a greedy algorithm. You try to find the maximum, minimum, and put it the value at the first point, but actually that will be slower. Any question regarding bubble sort, selection sort, and insertion sort, you please raise me. Yes. Okay. Okay, you can ask me any question right now. This is insertion sort. Like first it compare two values, 3, 5, then 3, 5, 8 is okay. Then 4, put the value 4 here. Then 6 should be there. This is the insertion. It is the best sorting algorithm without divide and conquer. That is the reason you get the complexity O n square. If you divide and conquer means you get it halved, then in half like Marsh sort, then you get the advantage n log n, but never n. Sorting algorithm is n log n or O n square. Well, n is 32 or 64, your n square algorithm is better than n log n algorithm. So if you have to sort data with 32 items or 64 items, you always go for insertion sort. That is the best. Any question? This is insertion sort. Best case is O n, like bubble. Bubble sort is O n. Average is O n square, worst is O n square. Heap sort is another divide and conquer. I'll cover in any other class with some Python code into it. So okay, any question?